Okay, so now we're on the doors. Cabinets all jointed together so we can start doing the pretty stuff. Look, I got short air because this was done about a month before I started the rest of the cabinet. So you can see why I put this in categories rather than chronological order, because I would have done this and then you would have completely forgotten about it. I'd have made the cabinet and they'd be like, oh, look, my doors were all made again. So that's why it's in this order now. But anyway, getting these all ripped down to a parallel width to the absolute maximum size I could. These are what actually dictated the size of the cabinet overall, because they're such unique pieces. I had to work with them rather than work with them. So I had two pieces of this, but I wanted to get the most out of each of them, so I decided to bookmatch them rather than use both for each panel, or rather than using two for two panels, I could bookmatch both of them and create four panels. So now I have two extras for a future project. So if anyone has any ideas, actually, send them my way, because I've just got two panels that look exactly the same as they do on this now, but I quite want to use them for something else, but I can't think what else. So anyway, yeah, send me your suggestions. Do that on here, or I'm on Twitter, Instagram, probably Twitter, that'd be pretty cool. There you go, there's the bookmatch. Looks amazing. I keep thinking it looks like a clock tower on fire or something like that, something narcissistic like that. But anyway, once those are all bandsawed, get those thicknessed on the drum sander. So that's like a nice little pinchy device, so you can measure the thickness of it without actually having to measure it. It's great. Feed those through, get them all cleaned up to an even thickness. It's not worth putting something like this through the thickness of, because that knot in the middle is pretty much entirely end grain. So if you put that through the thickness of it, it would probably just blow up. Oh, recognise these offcuts from the legs. Always keep your offcuts. So I got the nice wood from the front legs. It was a lot more streaky than the back stuff, and resawn that to make the rails and stiles for the fronts of the doors, or for the doors themselves. Get those all planed up. Get them thicknessed. There we go, that's all the rough components sorted, so I just needed to cut them to size. So I cut the stiles to size first, which were the uprights, and then for the rails, I did a bit of grain orientation to make the cabinet look a little bit more rounded. So you can see how I'm orientating these. They kind of like, if you look at the direction of the grain, it's always going in a circle. So it just adds to that overall roundness of the cabinet. It's not something you would notice unless I said it, but there you go, now you're going to notice it. And you know, if it was the wrong way around, something would look askew in there, but you wouldn't know what it was. So now that I've done that, hopefully that eliminates one of the possibilities. Now what I've done here is created two stop locations on the fence, and that's because I can't be bothered to put a tongue on the edge of the rail. I want to just have a straight joint like that, because it's just so much easier. I don't have to mess around with a tenoner. So if I stop that groove from hitting the end grain, it means that I can hide it within the style and just not have to faff about trying to fill the hole afterwards. So that, bring it away just before the groover hits the edge of the end grain. And now I'm finding this centre mark of that knot, marking either side of it, so I can get the overall size of the panel. And cut that size on the panel saw. And then to do the frame, just did a simple domino. Get that all smashed into place. So obviously panels, when there are doors like this, to allow for expansion and contraction, never glue them in place. So that'll stop the wood from getting stuck and ripping itself apart. So only glue the joints, don't glue the panel in place, unless it's something like MDF obviously, and then get them all clamped up. This was actually a dry fit at this point because I still needed to shape the door. So here I'm using the template, or an offcut of the template I used to shape the front curves of the horizontal shelves. So I cut that to a more usable size, and then I can mark that curve on the front of the doors. Now there was debate whether I should have curved the panel as well. Obviously that would have been incredibly difficult. So the panel is flat, but it's within a curved frame. Or the front of it's curved, the back of it's still flat. So it's not something I thought would be worth the time investment, and I don't think it was. It would have just been an absolute nightmare trying to curve that panel. So get that sanded back on the bobbin sander. And then where the curve started on the stiles, could put a marking gauge line from top to bottom on that. And then that would allow me to plane down to that line to match the radius on the rails of the door. There we go. Look at this focus. Oh, yeah. That's good. So, sanding. The drum sander obviously leaves quite a rough finish, so I had to get all those out first. Easier to sand the panels now rather than when they're in the frames. And also those internal faces. Definitely do that first. Getting these all glued up. By the way, if you haven't done it already and you're on Instagram, so am I. So if you fancy it, give me a quick follow on there, because I do quite regular updates and you can see all the behind the scenes and pretty pictures. And yeah, you know, a bit of procrastination never hurt anyone. Then I just measured if they were actually parallel or not. Not sure why they wouldn't be, but you know, it's good to be sure in situations like this. So with those glued up, I had to plane a small angle on the hinge side of the door. So to do that, I marked it off with a knife against the cabinet. And you see that little mark there on the corner? Match that with the marking gauge. Go down the door from top to bottom, leaving me a small line, and then I can just plane that back using the front corner as a safety line. So keep the front corner and then plane down to that line. And that would angle the door correctly in the carcass so it matched the inside divider, like that. And then just using 0.6mm veneer, which is the standard size, I can use those as spacers to get the even shadow gap around the whole thing. So now to sort the hinges out. So if you buy them normally, they're a bit crap. I mean, look how uneven that is. So to sort that out, put a bit of veneer between the two leaves and then use a file clamp sideways in a vise like this. And that gets them nice and parallel to one another, because what happens if you mark engage those leaves into the cabinet and they're out of square, it means that it's going to put the doors out of square as well. So it's, you know, it can really throw things off. And I also hate the shininess of brass hinges like that, so I tend to put them into a satin shine. So this that I'm using here is like an abrasive rubber. It's actually for getting rid of rust on tools, but it works incredibly well for this. So there's the bought one on the left and my new satin finish one on the right. Needs a little bit of finishing further from that point, but it just takes that horrible, it looks like urine. I just can't get the picture out of my head. It just looks horrible. Now, location for hinges. Put them in line with the rails of the doors. It just makes it look a little bit nicer. So that's what I was using the square for there. And marking the, or getting the thickness of the leaves. Mark that into the doors. And then square that line across. Thank you. distance from the front of the leaf to the knuckle of the pivot point, mark that inwards. And using a chisel, do a series of small notches to weaken the grain. Take advantage of the short grain, and you can just whack that out with a chisel and then finish it off with a router plane or an electric router if you're feeling incredibly dangerous and daring. And then fit it in place. Very nice and snug, look at that. Oh, that's good. So, and then drill those in place. So with those hinges screwed in, you can get your spacers back in place within the carcass and then mark the edge of those hinges against the carcass. So they're only attached to the door at this point. And then again, you use your same marking gauges to mark your depths. Chisel in those using the same method. And then use a router plane on its side. Don't do this with an electric router. you could do, I suppose, if it was a palm router, but oh my, good luck to you. Now at this point I had to do the shelves as well, so I just lit those, veneered them, and then marked some curves on them. And this was because when I was drilling the shelf pinholes, you see how close they are to the back of the door there? Essentially, the shelves were far too close to the back of the door that I have to use those as a stop as well. This was just because I didn't follow my drawing properly, because I thought I'd be smart. So now I'm just whacking the door against the shelves, and you can see that little burnish spot in the semicircle I've marked there? That allows me to see where to plane, and I can get the doors to stop right up against the shelves, but still flush with the front of the cabinet. It was a small cock-up. Again, it was just me changing plans last minute, not thinking about the repercussions later on. What I'm making here is a door stop for the top corner. Using a masking tape instead of a marking gauge line gives you a small positive stop, so it's a little bit easier to mark, to put it in the right place. So I just double-sided tape it to start with, and then using a fancy clamping method, glue it in place against the edge of the masking tape. Now here I'm making handles. Decided against like any sort of brass hardware for this because I can never find anything that looks good. So I'm making like dovetail shaped handles that are going to be recessed into the edge of the door. So this is the dovetail part of it now. And then fate said that yogurt pots are the perfect radius for a door handle, so you know, gotta use it if it's there. There you go. Now I made four of these in case I cocked one of them up. Always good to make spares, especially when you're me. And if you cut these when they're in a big line like that, it also minimises the risk of you chopping your fingers off, which is great. Yep, nothing fancy about this, just sanding them back on the belt sander. Make sure your bed's pretty close to the belt when you do this though, because you don't want the bit of wood getting sucked down there as well as your fingers. There we go. Like any normal dovetail, you then put that in the right location and then mark around that with a knife. That gives you a point to chisel back to. And then mark and gauge the depth of the handle in the front of the cabinet so I know how far to drill down in this case. But also I can put the chisel in that marking gauge line afterwards and chisel down to a nice flat base. There you go, smash it out. Then refine it back to that marking gauge line with a chisel and a router plane. Simple glue in place. I don't know why, but I've filmed the worst fitting one of the two of them. The other one was much better than this. It's alright once it's all been sanded, but look at that horrible gap on the left there. Poor attempt. That was all the doors done. Next week, we'll start working on the drawers. So we'll see you then.